in 1964. When Dr. King was marching from Selma to Montgomery, I was 3 months old. And in April of 1968, when Dr. King was shot on the hotel balcony, I was 3. I wish I could have met him, known him. But I have spent my adult life learning about him as a historical figure, like Jesus or Gandhi, who inspired Dr. King. So my reflection today is not about growing up as a child of the civil rights movement, but as an adult trying to learn to live true to what it stood for. I would like to share 4 things I believe I have learned from Dr. King. The civil rights movement is not only about race. Dr. King is perhaps best remembered for his nonviolent civil disobedience against racism, but in the later years of his life, he was increasingly outspoken about poverty and militarism. He looked toward universal human rights and surprised many of his followers by speaking out against the Vietnam War and questioning America's role in the larger community. At the time he was killed, he was organizing a campaign against poverty that crossed racial boundaries and address the economic structures that institutionalize poverty in our country. It's hard to say what Dr. King would be doing and saying if he were alive today, but we can imagine. Would he be popular among the educated middle class? Or would he remind us that we are tangled in the trappings of success and material excess? Would he be popular with corporate America? Or would he call out the unchecked greed, high bonuses, profit at the expense of the working class? Would he be popular with elected officials in the White House, as he preached about peaceful ways to resolve conflict while we continue to flex our military muscles across the globe? Dr. King lived his beliefs and translated his deep faith into action. Would he be popular with our culturally accommodated American church? Second thing, doing nothing is not okay. Sometimes you have to be brave and do what's right as a person and as a church. The challenges that face Dr. King are still with us. While legal racism is largely of the past, there are plenty of faces of social injustice that confront us every day. I wish for the courage that Martin Luther King Jr. had in his pinky finger to speak out my beliefs. In his own words, he who accepts evil without protesting against it is really cooperating with it. Or worse, history will record that the greatest tragedy was not the strident clamor of the bad people, but the appalling silence of the good people. I ask myself, how often have I been guilty of appalling silence? Dr. Cornel West cautions against the Santa Clausification of Dr. King, as he puts it. If our celebrations are polite, smiling, sugar-coated, we might lose sight of the man that the FBI called the most dangerous man in America, because his fundamental commitment to justice did not allow for the comfort of the status quo. In his words, cowardice asks, is it safe? Expediency asks, is it politically correct? Vanity asks, is it popular? But conscience asks, is it right? Dr. King did not do what he did because it was safe, politically correct, or popular. He did what was brave and right. And as a church, so should we. He said, the church must be reminded that it is not the master or the servant of the state, but rather the conscience of the state. It must be the guide and critic of the state and never its tool. If the church does not recapture its prophetic zeal, it will become an irrelevant social club without moral or spiritual authority. Third thing, there are many different kinds of violence. I recently read an article that referred to the violence of partisan politics. I was initially put off by the word, but on further reflection, I considered that not all violence is physical. Webster says violence can injure by distortion, infringement, or profanation. can be an intense, turbulent, furious, or destructive force. I think that Dr. King might be horrified by our inability to move forward as a country because neither side is willing to give ground to the other. Dr. King once said, "Men often hate each other because they fear each other. They fear each other because they don't know each other. They don't know each other because they cannot communicate, and they cannot communicate because they are separated." He wasn't talking here about Republicans and Democrats, but he could have been. I believe he would have preached for healing of our political system. Each session of the House or Senate could begin with these words of Dr. King. "In a real sense, all life is interrelated. I can never be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be. You can never be what you ought to be until I am what I ought to be." And maybe something would get done. The last thing that I learned from Dr. King is that it's my job to ask, what is my dream? It's not good enough for me to rest on his. We each need to sit in quiet moments and say, "I have a dream today. I have a dream that..." And there are many to choose from. Mine might look like this. Mine might look like gay and lesbian folks sitting in church side by side with us with equal rights, both in the church and under the law. That our church would be as welcoming a place for them as any place they could find. That a youth from our youth group who had questions about gender or sexuality might find this to be a safe place, a soft place to fall. Your dream might not be the same as mine, but whatever yours is, I believe Martin Luther King Jr. would ask you, what will you do to make your dream happen? Who will you tell about it? Who can help you in your cause? What would you give up for your dream? What are you willing to sacrifice? When you're gone, what will people say about you? Were you a drum major for your dream? Please briefly close in a word of prayer with me. Let us each be challenged by the legacy of Dr. King, soaked in his words, steeped in the memory of his courageous acts, and humbled by his unswerving commitment to justice.